Welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about cephalosporins and specifically the different generations of cephalosporins, some representative antibiotics in each class, and what are the unique things about those generations and what they do in their coverage. So there are five generations of cephalosporins. We've got the first generation cephalosporin. We've got the second, which we'll talk about. The third, which is the workhorse of the pneumonia scene. We've got the fourth generation, which has got the pseudomonal coverage, some also in the third. And then finally, the fifth, which is an interesting generation that we'll talk about. The first generation of cephalosporins, as we go from first to second to third to fourth, you'll see that there is better and better gram-negative coverage. So at the very beginning, with the first generation cephalosporins, we have medications like cefazolin and cephalexin. And these antibiotics really have no anaerobic coverage. So no anaerobic coverage. But what they did have a lot of coverage for is gram-positive. So this is going to be our gram-positive box, and this is going to be our gram-negative box. So in terms of gram-positives, it had really good staph and actually pretty good strep coverage. So where do we see these things being used? We see these things being used in, for instance, skin infections, because this has got really good gram-positive coverage. No anaerobic coverage, good staph and strep. And in terms of gram-negative, it would still take care of, you know, your regular gram-negatives like E. coli, like Proteus, and like Klebsiella. Okay? When they went on to second-generation cephalosporins, here we're talking about medications like cefuroxime and like cefotetan. So the biggest thing about this was that now we had anaerobic coverage. That was the big thing. And so as a result of that, we're looking at intra-abdominal. And the reason why we could do that was because there's a lot of anaerobic bacteria intra-abdominally. But in terms of the staph and strep, it stayed the same. Going from the first generation to the second, there was really no change. So we didn't lose much in terms of staph and strep. But going from first generation to second generation, we actually got a little bit better gram-negative coverage. So that's what really made it really well in terms of intra-abdominal infections. The second generation was better in terms of that. Okay, let's go on to the third generation. Third generation cephalosporins, there's three major examples, and you should know these. One of them is ceftriaxone. The other one is cefotaxime. And the last one is a very important one called ceftazidime. We'll talk about that one in a little bit. In terms of anaerobic coverage, well, it lost it again. So not anaerobic. No anaerobic coverage here, whereas we had it back in the second generation. Now, in terms of gram-positives here, it was okay. Definitely very good in pneumococcus. Okay? But in terms of staph, probably not as good a coverage in terms of staph aureus. Because it has good pneumococcal coverage, third generation cephalosporins were really good at lung infections. So we're talking about community acquired pneumonia. Now, there's a couple of things I should mention here, and that's very specifically that ceftazidime is covering Pseudomonas. And that's an important thing that we're going to have to bring up here when we talk about gram negatives, is that here it's even better. You can see as we go up the list here in terms of generations that the gram negative coverage just keeps getting better. Specifically, if you're using ceftazidime, you can now cover Pseudomonas. But even if you're not, we're talking good coverage with Neisseria gonorrhea. We're talking about Enterobacteriaceae, so Enterobacter. We're talking about Serratia. So Enterobacter, Serratia, Neisseria, gonorrhea, it's better. And here's the big one. If you use ceftazidime, it'll cover Pseudomonas. Now that's a big one because Pseudomonas is the infection that people get in nursing homes, specifically in their lung. So that's third generation. Probably one of the best up to that point in terms of gram-negative coverage. Now, fourth generation, the big one that you gotta know there is cefepime. Now, cefepime is important because it also covers the big P, the big Pseudomonas. Okay, in terms of anaerobic coverage, still no anaerobic coverage. So far, the only one that actually covers anaerobes is the second generation cephalosporins. Now, the fourth generation cephalosporins were something quite amazing because what it did is it took the strength of the first generation for gram positives, okay, so really strong, and it added the great gram negative coverage of the third and made it strong. So cefepime is really outstanding. And so what were we using these for? We were using these for very serious infections anywhere. So I'll put serious here because it's got excellent coverage, strong gram-positive, strong gram-negative, and the extra bonus is it covers Pseudomonas. So we can think of, like, for instance, immunocompromised patients or fever of unknown origin, okay? So this fourth generation cephalosporin had excellent, excellent coverage. Now, when we go to the fifth generation cephalosporin is kind of unusual because we've got different players in that generation, which are very, very different from each other. The first one that I want to talk to you about is a long one called ceftolozane. And it actually is combined with tazobactam, which is a beta-lactamase inhibitor. Okay, ceftolozane, tazobactam. And the other one is ceftaroline. These are very different fifth-generation cephalosporins. Again, for the second time, we have good anaerobic coverage. You should know that it's really just the second generation and the fifth generation that have anaerobic coverage. But let's talk a little bit more about these two players. Ceftolozane, tazobactam, this first one, what they did was they took ceftazidime, okay, that structure, and they basically made it better. And so that this is actually the most potent anti-pseudomonal cephalosporin that we currently have. And they added on a tazobactam, which is a beta-lactamase inhibitor. So this is a super anti-pseudomonal that works well. So just to review, we've got three cephalosporins that have anti-pseudomonal coverage, and I think that's important to know. You should know that ceftazidime, cefepime, and ceftolozane are. Now, we use ceftriaxone as our third generation cephalosporin to treat community-acquired pneumonia. Notice that ceftriaxone, or Rocephin, does not have any anti-pseudomonal coverage. So if a patient is coming in from a nursing home or some institution or a hospital that they're at risk for having Pseudomonas, you should not use ceftriaxone. Do not use ceftriaxone because ceftriaxone has no anti-pseudomonal coverage. The only one that has anti-pseudomonal coverages is ceftazidime, cefepime, and ceftolozane. Okay? So this is a great anti-pseudomonal medication. Now, what is ceftaroline? What is so good about it? Actually, ceftaroline, Tefloro is the trade name, actually covers MRSA. It is the only cephalosporin that can actually treat MRSA. Okay, so that's pretty important. It's currently indicated for skin and soft tissue infections and also community-acquired pneumonia. It has not, as of this taping, gotten the FDA approval for MRSA pneumonia. One other bit of advice, information I want to give you is sometimes when they're actually testing bacteria like gram-negatives for cefepime, they'll notice that it is sensitive to cefepime, but it's not sensitive to any other cephalosporin. This you should think about in terms of if it is possible to be an extended spectrum beta lactamase. If they are, you should not use any cephalosporins whatsoever and should switch to the monolactam, and we'll talk about that in one of our next lectures. So just to review again here, we've got the first, second, third, fourth, and fifth generation. The first generation was really good on gram-positive staph and strep, did not have anaerobic coverage, and had so-so gram-negative coverage. Really good for skin infections like cefazolin, cephalexin, okay? But because it had good gram-negative coverage like E. coli, you could use it in simple urinary tract infections. Going to second generation, we've got anaerobic coverage. We've got better gram-negative coverage. This is intra-abdominal because of that anaerobic and better gram-negative coverage. Third generation is the workhorse for community-acquired pneumonia because of the ceftriaxone. But you should also know that it also holds ceftazidime, which is an anti-pseudomonal, and it's got one of the best gram-negative coverages out of all of the generations. Fourth generation took the best of both worlds. It took the first generation gram-positive coverage, and it took the third generation gram-negative coverage, put it all together, and you got cefepime, which is anti-pseudomonal, okay? So it was for serious infections where you needed really good broad-spectrum antibiotics. Finally, the fifth generation has two odd players that are really different from each other, ceftolozane, which is the anti-pseudomonal, which you have to worry about in hospital-acquired infections, but also MRSA coverage with ceftaroline, also something you have to worry about in hospital-acquired infections. Two different drugs, same generation. Okay, well, thanks for joining us.